Now, this is a very ambitious title, and you will be disappointed because I'll take only one very precise case, a historical case, and that is labor struggles in Slovenia in the last 20 and more year, 20, 22, 23, 25 years. And then I will comment on the trends we can perceive in Slovenia on the background of general trends within contemporary capitalism. The labor struggles in Slovenia after the destruction of Yugoslavia were led by trade unions, by a pluralistic set of trade union organizations, I will show you the most important actions, manifestations by those trade unions, and I ask you to turn attention to the mobilization power of trade unions, that is, to the number of participants to particular manifestations. So in 1992, there was a general strike with 400,000 participants, which means half of the labor power in Slovenia, which was at that time and still is 800,000. This was a strike against liberal reforms and was successful. Its most important achievement was that the government abandoned the shock liberal reforms project, and that the parliament introduced a new organizational form, which was called Economic Social Council, and that is a negotiation body composed of representatives of the labor trade unions, selective, let's say, representative trade unions are there, of chamber of industry and chamber of commerce craft, the chambers that represent the capital, plus the government as a mediating power instance. So in 96 there was a general strike with 250 participants against the unilateral break of the general collective agreement by the Chamber of Industry. And again, this strike was successful. The government pushed the representatives of capital to re-enter, to re-engage in this general agreement. Now, in 2005, there was a mass manifestation against radical liberal reforms again by a new government, which was conservative, led by Mr. Prime Minister Janša, whom many of you know from different episodes of Yugoslav and post-Yugoslav history. And again, it was successful. It brought down the government. The government gave up reforms and basically was neutralized, paralyzed until the end of its mandate. In 2007, there was the most massive manifestation in Ljubljana, 70,000 participants, which is quite a lot because in Ljubljana, the city of Ljubljana has around less than 200,000 inhabitants, so 70,000 are a kind of massive presence in such a city. I'll show you the photos, which are quite impressive, and this was a manifestation for minimum wage, for public education, and for higher pensions. And again, it was roughly saying it was successful. There was another mass manifestation in 2009 with 30,000 participants. You see the decreasing number. And for the raise of the minimum wage against pension reform, and it stopped the pension reform and it raised the minimum wage, so it was again successful. There was another mass manifestation 3 years ago in 2012 with 20,000 participants for social state and public services. It was a kind of general project, and we don't know how successful that was. So this is the 2005 manifestation. It was snowing, it was November, so it was quite pathetic. I mean, there was a media struggle before. The radio on the day of this manifestation was announcing that the main routes to Ljubljana are closed because of the snow, which was not true. I was marching with somebody who came from Primorska, from the littoral, and said, well, we were, there were announcements we couldn't reach Ljubljana, but I nevertheless went, and, there, and I'm okay. So. So there was this manifestation, quite pathetic. It was plural, ideologically pluralistic. This is the anarchist part of this cortege, which says, the sign says, capitalism cannot be reformed for radical social transformation. So this is the largest manifestation, 70,000 participants in 2007. This is the main trade union. They have those red caps, and the slogan says "For Social Slovenia." That's the other another view of this same the same manifestation. So this is 2009, 30,000 participants, a smaller group, and the banner in front is metal workers. The most radical, trade union in the great trade union confederation. So this is the membership of the trade union in Slovenia from 92 till 2013. The same period I was showing you in heroic photos, I'm now showing you statistical hard data, and you see that the percentage of labor of labor which is unionized is more or less falling, with a small episode around 2003. Basically, it's decreasing, and it's dramatically decreasing. You see that it's one third now from the 92, the beginning. This is a general trend. Those are the same graphs for United Kingdom in light blue, Germany in bold blue, and Italy in green. So you see that the trade union membership is decreasing also in other parts, in the important parts of Europe. Now I come to the interpretation. My interpretation is based on operaist theory of class composition. I draw this picture, a schematic presentation of this theory. I reduce the theory to main elements, and that is that this capitalism classically is based upon the separation of labor power from means of production. So the MP at the top means of production. And on the bottom you have PCLC. It's I'm sorry, I couldn't. I had problem at putting this in, on PowerPoint, and I was doing it on other people's computers. So that's why you have those enigmatic short anagrams. So there is a political piece. The next towards the bottom, the next instance is technical composition of labor power, which is the concept introduced by Operaist theory, which means labor power is integrated into a certain historical stage of capitalism, and by adapting this labor power to the present stage of technology, which is invented to crush the political composition of labor class, which is in the bottom. Now, what I think is important in this schematization of operaist movement is that the temporality of labor is different from the temporality of capital. The new technological unity, and it was most Comrade Bologna showed this very convincingly when he studied the transition from pre-World War I technological composition in Germany to Fordism. Because Fordism, as you know, dequalifies labor and introduces new technologies, which means much more real submission of labor to capital in Marxian terms. So the resistance of labor to this new technological unity is first caught within the old pattern, within the old political composition of labor, of working class, of labor class, which belongs to the past, T minus one, which is basically trade unions of the past or political parties of the past. Now, if this resistance of labor is to be efficient, it has to get out of the present pattern of organization of production of surplus value. So the political composition that corresponds to the technological unity T of one moment in history is outside this pattern, this paradigm. It's displaced, and it's in red. Here, political composition of labor class. And this political composition has to do, besides the evident political task, has to make a theoretical analysis of the present state of capitalism, but it also criticizes the past class composition of the labor class, and it meets resistances. There are resistances to criticism, and that's why labor movement is always marked by clashes of fractions, by sectarianism, and it is successful if these clashes, which are inevitable, are made productive. And for instance, Bolshevik Party or Lenin were moments when these internal clashes of the labor movement were made productive. That's not the case always. They can be destructive. So, of course, there is a resistance to this criticism, and more importantly, there's a resistance to theory. You have all which is now in our contemporary moment, this resistance to theoretical analysis from the point of view of the labor is extremely efficient. It's this bizarre composition of ideological premises and very hard knowledge, which is put into the service of reproduction of the existing relations of exploitation. Now, this scheme has actually been anticipated by Marx in 18th Brumaire, when he describes what he thought would be the revolutions of the 19th century, the proletarian revolutions, and he says they have to criticize their beginnings, their opponent is rising again and again, and stronger and stronger. So you see this. It's actually, according to Operaille's theory, it's the class struggle of the labor class which is pushing history, the development history. Up till now, it's pushing the development of capitalism. Capitalism reinvents itself and creates new stages. And this is what Marx says, that the opponent is rising huger and huger against the labor movement until, of course, the moment revolution comes, if it comes. So now I give you another quotation from Communist Manifesto, which explains why the authors of Manifesto could have an optimistic view of history. Because that's the same motive which is also presented all over Grundrisse, a later text by Marx. It is that the idea is that capitalism is creating the conditions for its own transgression, for its own transcending, and concretely. Manifesto thinks that the organization of labor, of production, in the factory system brings together individual workers who are in competition on the labor market, but who, coming to the factory, which is actually a barracks, an army barracks, hierarchically organized, they come together and they can organize, associate. So in this way, with factory system, the authors of the manifesto thought that bourgeoisie is producing its own grave diggers, and that's why they are optimistic. Now, why obviously the working class composition failed in Slovenia? There were specific and general causes. The specific causes were that the formation of the Economic Social Council, which was an achievement of the labor movement, was a trap, because it integrated trade unions into the system, and of course bureaucratization of trade unions was a necessary consequence of this. They had to develop develop specialist skills to be able to conduct negotiations within a technocratic frame set by, of course, by the representatives of capital, which means by the chambers of industry, commerce, etc., and the government. The other are two compromises. One was social compromise and the other was political compromise. The social compromise that held during the 90s was that the state will preserve public services, the government will preserve public services plus main elements of the social state in exchange of privatizations and intensification of work. And the other was political compromise, which means there was a large political consensus of the accession to the European Union, and the conditions for the accession were met at the expense of labor. And another very typical phenomenon in Slovenia was that the conditions for EU accession, the conditions for international competitivity, were met by intensification of labor, not by new technological inventions and new types of organization of labor processes, which means an old type of exploitation was reintroduced, which is called in Marxist theory production of absolute surplus value. Longer working hours, working during the weekends, working faster, which means intensify the time. And And what did this mean? This meant that also bourgeoisie failed in class composition. They were unable to compose themselves into a contemporary capitalist class, even though the whole idea of destruction of Yugoslavia was the creation of nation states by national bourgeoisies. So the previous elite groups, technocrats, political party, bureaucracy, cultural bureaucracy, very important, had the project of creating a national bourgeoisie, and this project failed. It was anachronistic anyway. It was an 1848 project. But, I mean, in one, it won democratic elections. So, in all the parts of Yugoslavia. The specifics why bourgeoisie failed the reasons why bourgeoisie failed to compose themselves into a real capitalist class, national bourgeoisie, are specific and general. Specific are privatizations meant mostly what's called in jargon bleeding of the companies, which means individual appropriation of the profit and exportation of this profit to international financial markets and to the tax havens, of course, and the like. The other was this production of the absolute surplus value consented by the workers. And of course, a very specific cause, easy credit at the beginning of the 2000s, and this speculation crumbled in 2008, because the way how privatizations were operated was a mechanism which is called in specialist literature leverage buyout, which basically means that the workers of the company pay the credit for the owner. The general cause for the failure, for the mutual failure, both of the labor and the bourgeoisie to compose themselves into real contemporary class, was the inability to integrate their class politics into historical processes of contemporary capitalism. They had Fordist ideas in their heads. They had Fordist or even pre-Fordist bourgeoisie had pre-Fordist ideas of exploitation, so they were unable to compose themselves into a class on the level of the present capitalism. So, the problem is that neither the two classes failed to compose themselves, and you can see what is this is part and parcel of the European Union processes that are contemporary and that are now under the way. This is my again schematic presentation of the social situation in present capitalism. To the separation number one, which is constitutive of capitalism and separates labor power from organization of production and means of production, there is added a separation number two, which cuts off, separates whole production processes in different ways from the conditions of socialization. This is called outsourcing, subcontracting, or monopsonic relations, which means that factories in our countries, that's true for Slovenia and Croatia, I don't know about Serbia, are actually subcontractors of big international or transnational monopolies. And when those monopolies decide to cut down their production or to change the line of production, they can cut off the contract, and this happened with Mura. Mura, the textile factory everybody knows in Yugoslavia, the good clothes, is the good kind of pret-a-porter that was providing whole Yugoslavia, was a subcontractor of Boss, Bosch is a textile giant competing with the Chinese. At a certain moment, it cut off the contract, and the whole region around this factory of Mura went unemployed. Now, in industrial capitalism or national capitalism or Fordist capitalism, the tendency, overall tendency, was towards homogenization of social field, the households had could rely upon sources of income, and the long-term planning of household economy was possible, and all this was embedded in national culture, which was again the cultural, sociocultural foundation of national nation state. Now, in present fragmented conditions of sociality, the social composition of labor power, which I introduced as a concept to enlarge the technical composition of labor power of the operaists, the social composition of labor power is fragmented, is heterogeneous, which means that the sources of income of household are precarious, uncertain, and heterogeneous. You know, mother has lost her job and is now working in the kitchen. The father is in precarious work, working by projects. The young daughter sells at the flea market whatever she can get from family heritage, and the older son comes from time to time with larger sums of money. Nobody wants to ask where they come from. So that's the modern family, and of course discipline within this family has to be strengthened, because it depends on everybody. So you have to control especially women and younger people. And how can you control them? By the means at hand. What are the means at hand? Religion, ethnic solidarity, patriarchal family ties. So we see what we call erroneously retraditionalization of societies, but it's reaction of people who are poor, who are living in precarious conditions, to their real life conditions. And of course, national culture has exploded. Now we have identity cultures, we have ethnic, religious, everybody is minority, everybody is a hypochondriac, wants to defend the identity rights. And of course, it's very difficult to compose a labor movement in such a situation. Thank you.
Well, hi, good afternoon. Can you hear me? Yeah. I'd like to thank the organizers of the conference. It's such an interesting and stimulating conference. I'm really, really happy to be here. Thank you for being here. And thank you for pronouncing my name perfectly. You have a perfect Portuguese accent. And as you may notice, I'm not Arthur Bueno, I'm Mariana Teixeira. Unfortunately, my colleague will arrive only on Friday, so I don't know if you got the chance to read the abstract. We propose to make an analysis of Axel Honneth's and Georg Simmel's concepts of social pathologies. But I'm not up to the task to analyze Simmel's conception, because Arthur is a great specialist in Simmel. So, yeah, and people tend to have more sympathy for Simmel than Honneth, so I'm sorry about that. And if you want to talk maybe with Arthur on Friday, informally, we can discuss a little bit about that. So I'm going to read my paper. If I start to read too fast, please stop me and I'll try to speak slower. This paper intends to discuss the relevance of the concept of social pathology for analyzing and criticizing some of the normatively problematical aspects of life under capitalism. The reference point is provided by Axel Honneth's writings, which have for 20 years put forward and further developed that concept as a central means for a critical theory of modern social relations, including those established within economic sphere. I will begin by briefly presenting two accounts of social pathologies that can be found in Honneth's work. First, the idea developed in 1994 of pathologies of the social as the object of social philosophy. And second, the distinction formulated from 2011 to 2014 between social misdevelopments, pathologies of the social, and diseases of society. I will show that in the two decades that separate these approaches, there is a functionalist turn. I will then turn to the diagnosis of pathologies under capitalism in Honneth's most recent work, Freedom's Right, in order to extract the consequences of this functionalist shift. So the first two accounts of social pathologies, the pathologies of the social as the object of social philosophy. On an essay published 2 years after Struggle for Recognition, which is the most known book of Honneth, he proposes a reading of social philosophy's history as a theoretical tradition that, from Rousseau to contemporary authors, has set its own task as the diagnosing of social disorders and misdevelopments, or, in his own words, pathologies of the social. Identifying and discussing social processes of development can be seen as pathological. Identifying and discussing social processes of development that can be seen as pathological is what distinguishes social philosophy. This means, for Honneth, that this theoretical tradition grants preeminence to the negativity. Rousseau, for example, contrary to Hobbes, is more concerned with the causes of civil bourgeois society's degeneration than with the preconditions of its maintenance. For Honneth, thus, Rousseau can be considered the father of social philosophy, less for the content of his critical social diagnosis than for the kind of investigation and the methodological framework of his answer. He conceived the philosophical idea, even if not the concept itself, of alienation, which allowed for philosophy to go beyond the investigation of a social life form, aiming at its moral political legitimation, looking instead for the structural limitations it imposes on human self-realization. So in a post-metaphysical context, it is necessary, however, to define what criteria are the most appropriate to identify such limitations and therefore social pathologies. Honneth considers two philosophical positions to be apparently adequate for such a task: a philosophical anthropology, a weak philosophical anthropology, and the resurgence in the debate against historicism of a weaker version of the philosophy of history. These positions are different in regard to each one's conception of human universality. They refer either to a sufficiently complex description of the human starting point, or to an anticipation of the social state in which human history would reach its necessary conclusion. Throughout the 20th century, the diagnosis of social pathologies relied on one or the other of these modes of justification. Although different, they share a key feature. As stated initially, all kinds of social philosophy are marked by the primacy of negativity. I quote Honneth, "At no point does social philosophy appear as a positive theory. It is instead, first and foremost, a critique of social circumstances perceived as alienated, meaningless, reified, or even ill." End of quotation. So this theoretical perspective presupposes, however, and even in an indirect fashion, the conditions for human self-realization. This becomes even clearer if one takes into account that the terms diagnosis and pathology stem from the medical field. If diagnosis is understood here as the precise detection and definition of an illness afflicting the human organism, there has got to be a standard according to which such abnormal phenomena and symptoms can be measured. This standard is provided by a certain notion of health. Of course, employing metaphors stemming from the medical field brings complications with it. Honneth emphasizes that such a shift in meaning requires appropriate mediations, which, however, are not always available to the social philosopher. So perhaps the main difficulty arises when trying to extend the use of both concepts, diagnosis and pathologies, to the scope of social phenomena, since here the reference point can no longer be the individual, and it is necessary to develop a concept of normality relative to social life as a whole. Honneth then states an important observation. It is not up to the theoretician as an external observer to define what is to be considered healthy and what is pathological. I quote him again, since what counts as a developmental goal or as normality in social contexts is always culturally defined, it is also only by a hermeneutic reference to a society's self-understanding that social functions or the corresponding disorders can be determined. End of quote. Honneth therefore advocates for a culturally contingent notion of normality. At the same time, however, he acknowledges that this essentially descriptive approach is not yet sufficient. At this point, Honneth introduces the idea of a formal ethics, which I won't be able to discuss here. And then, well, he turns his attention in an essay of published in 2004, entitled Social Pathology of Reason, where he advocates the need for a Habermas-inspired idea of emancipatory interest that should guide critical theory. Honneth reinforces here the idea that social pathologies are processes that prevent individuals from freely pursuing their conception of a good life, adding that this loss of prospect for intersubjective self-realization is necessarily accompanied by some kind of social suffering. So Honneth attributes to Freud the thought appropriated by critical theory that social pathologies must always express themselves in a type of suffering that keeps alive the interest in the emancipatory power of reason. End of quotes. So this experience is a painful one because for Honneth, human beings cannot remain indifferent in the face of an unjustified restriction of their rational capacities. This is a central feature that is abandoned in his most recent works. The second conception of social pathology, I took it from his last book, Freedom's Right, where there's a distinction between social pathologies and social misdevelopments. On the one hand, the terminology of social pathologies is employed for cases of unilateral absolutization of negative, be it legal or moral, models of freedom, as opposed to a broader conception of social freedom, so that the indeterminacy that is constitutive to them exceeds their limits as special forms and becomes the sole grounding of all social actions and social relations between individuals. On the other hand, Honneth identifies a number of social misdevelopments that affect the three spheres of ethical life, which are personal relations, market economy, and democratic reformation. Honneth then highlights deviations from patterns of action regarded as ideal typical for each ethical sphere. What distinguishes such misdevelopments from the social pathologies addressed before is the fact that they have external causes, while social pathologies ensue from the very action patterns of the corresponding ideas of freedom, legal or moral. In the long-range diagnosis of the present time that takes up the entire third of the book, however, there is no reference to the social pathologies described and analyzed in the previous sections, but only to a series of misdevelopments. In Freedom's Right, Honneth is therefore gradually distancing himself from the term social pathologies, which once was so central for his critical model. Honneth also moves away from the idea that the actor's suffering is an essential component of social disorders. It becomes thus clear that focusing on social misdevelopments instead of social pathologies favors the book's institutionalist and functionalist inclination, since they affect above all misdevelopments affect relational institutions, ethical spheres, and the balance between them, and not social subjects individually or collectively considered. This theoretical shift, characterized by the increasing importance of institutionalized social norms, and conversely by the shrinking relevance of normatively motivated social conflicts, is further reinforced in recent texts, which in which there is a radicalization of the functionalist trend already present in Freedom's Right. So in the essay, Diseases of Society, published in 2014, it is society itself that falls ill, as opposed to the sum or generalization of psychic pathologies of its individual members. And society is then impaired in its functional competence. According to Honneth, although medical evidence on the emergence and spread of certain types of individual illnesses are to a certain extent relevant for discovering deep disorders in the process of social integration, these disorders are not at the same level of the suffering and the illnesses of isolated social actors or even of groups of actors within society, so that between these two levels there is an ontological difference. There are thus cases where we can infer disorders in the social life from more or less vague indications, such as diffuse situations of uneasiness and disruptive or disturbing modes of behavior, that do not precipitate into functional disorders experienced by individuals as distinctively painful, and are not therefore perceived as diseases. Honneth admits that there need to be ways to identify social ills from individuals' pathological phenomena, but not necessarily from psychic diseases such as they are categorized by medicine or psychology. Well, there's here a confusion, I think, between individual psychic disease and individual psychic suffering. And I think that by denying the necessity of the presence of individual diseases for the diagnosis of social pathologies, Honneth ends up discarding also the idea, which was so important in his early works, that the suffering experienced by social subjects is a central feature underlying not only the identification, but also the very definition of social pathologies. This is due to the fact that in the functionalist framework Honneth now adopts, there is no room for the negative experiences that the members of society experience as such, that is, as negative, but only for what can be considered by the well-trained observer as a behavioral disorder. This point of view has decisive consequences. While the behavioral disorder can only be detected by the social philosopher, who takes on the role of an external observer, the understanding of social suffering requires for its turn the interactive and dialogical capacity for listening and interpreting individuals' manifestations of lived negative experiences. Honneth indicates more than once that, I quote, such social diseases occur in a fundamentally superior level than that of individuals, and thereby do not necessarily find a precipitation in functional disorders experienced by individuals as suffering, end of quote. He goes even further and claims to be necessary to give up analyzing disorders in the carrying out specific realization goals, and focusing instead on a higher level that consists of the interplay between reciprocal correlation between the functional spheres of social reproduction. The theoretical focus here is completely shift from conflictual processes that lead to social change to the functional aspects required for the reproduction of social order. This functionalist theoretical turn is further reinforced on the essay's conclusion, where Honneth proposes a parallel between society and organism. The author defends the strong thesis that the terminology of diseases of society can only be consistently and substantially employed if we represent society according to the model of a living organism, that's his words, in which the singular spheres or subsystems considered as organs may act reciprocally, harmoniously, in such a way that allows us to forge the idea of their unhindered free development. Now I'll turn to the diagnosis of social pathologies of capitalism, which I don't think I'll have the time to read. So let me see. But I'll try to cut a little bit. So in Pathologies of the Social, which is this essay from 1994, Hornet stresses the fact that up until the Second World War, virtually every author in the realm of social pathology, philosophy attributed social pathologies to the development of social relations and rationalization under capitalist exchange of commodities, since Hegel and Marx to Weber, Simmel, Tonis, Lukács, and so many others. He points out, however, that critical theory has shifted its direction, with attempts by authors such as Adorno, Horkheimer, and Hannah Arendt to explain totalitarianism and war. And I think this description applies to Honneth himself, because in his works of the 90s, he continues this trend in the pathologies that affect social actors in struggle for recognition are so far removed from problems of distribution of wealth and social inequalities that the book has been harshly criticized for this economic deficit, not to mention the political deficit, which is present too. So in the last few years, he tried to overcome these deficits, and the result of this attempt can be found in Freedom's Right, where the sphere of market economy and democratic reformation hold privileged positions. I don't know if you read the book, but the third part is really, it's very confused. It's not systematic in explaining which misdevelopments he sees in each sphere and what is the cause for each misdevelopment. So I tried to systematize it by identifying three kinds of critic: the social distributive, cultural relational, and reflexive political. But I won't explain everything now. If you want, I can talk about that later. The recent economic transformations, which are usually referred to by the term neoliberalism, can be considered widely anomalous from the criteria that he's developed. The prioritization of requirements imposed by autonomized market imperatives not only caused a very significant amount of the misdevelopment singled out by Honneth, but have also been historically associated with other forms of misdevelopments, such as racism, xenophobia, nationalism, and gender discrimination, which strengthen and enhance one another. The feature that seems to worry Honneth the most in this context is the phenomenon that has been called the capitalist formation of subjectivity. If this circumstance can be expanded beyond the realm of intimate relationships, and it appears to me that it can, Honneth fears there could be an ongoing transformation of the correlation or interplay between the different forms of social freedom and therefore of the very structure of democratic ethical life. There is thus the danger of an internal exhaustion or erosion of the institution of social freedom. What seems to be the potentially most serious consequence of the negation of the normative principles that are the basis of the capitalist market is a significant decrease in the motivation of individuals to engage in economic activities, whose operating rules are then considered illegitimate by its participants. When the shared norms that stem from the Marx promise of ensuring to individuals economic security, social recognition, and co-determination, when these shared norms lose their effect and solely the legally accepted condition of negative freedom are guaranteed, two types of crises emerge: legitimacy crisis and crisis in the functioning of the market mechanism. Without normative legitimacy or economic efficiency, the market seems doomed to a state of anomie that may lead to the collapse of the capitalist economic order as we know it. What I think it's ironic is that what was the object of Marx's hope and even of Marx's confidence seems to be precisely Honneth's greatest fear. And now I'll conclude. I think, do I have like 1 minute? Okay. Honneth's recent writings can be in part seen as the result of his attempt to solve the problems pointed out by his interlocutors, such as Nancy Fraser, for example. Notably, the criticisms indicating political and economic deficits in his theory of recognition. Freedom's Right displays, therefore, a number of advantages over Honneth's previous works. On the one hand, the enormous effort undertaken by Honneth to include the economic and political dimensions in his conceptual system, and thereby to show that recognition is not only a matter of culture, is truly remarkable. But there are, as well, on the other hand, some important disadvantages. This effort ended up by overemphasizing the role of the economic and political spheres to the extent that the former is considered, I mean the economic, is considered virtually as the only source of all social misdevelopments, and the latter, the political sphere, is seen as the only realm in which it would be possible to mitigate them. The situation is aggravated by the distinctively more institutionalist and functionalist conception of society that shapes the book, with resort to sociological theories of Durkheim and Parsons, so that there is less and less room to the analysis of the collective manifestation of the subject's pathological suffering in favor of the theoretical examination of misdevelopments that affect, as functional disorders, primarily the harmonious interplay between ethical institutions and relational spheres. So this tendency is deepened in diseases of society, as we saw, where society itself is conceived as an organism that is the subject afflicted by social pathologies. So this is what I'd like to say, that while trying to overcome what has been at times viewed as the weakness of the struggle for recognition paradigm, Honneth seems to have precisely abandoned its strength, that is, the ability to extract from the dynamics of social struggles and not from the steadiness of the already established, the very material of what we call the social. This results, I would like to argue, in a decrease in the critical nature of Honneth's theoretical model. So in spite of Honneth's overall improvement in the analysis of capitalist social disorders in freedom's right, the theoretical shift regarding his conception of social pathologies leads to a potentially less explosive critical theory, not to say a hesitant reformism that does not account for the social suffering of the subjects as a motivation drive that points beyond capitalist social and economic relations. Can I read just a little bit? This is the last paragraph. So the social misdevelopments of the ethical life, exclusion, disaggregation, the categories he used to describe misdevelopments are descriptive categories which are arrived at only by the observing social philosopher, so that he is the one who measures monologically the extent to which social actors have reached self-realization. As we could see, Honneth's insistence in the conditions of intact social reproduction and his abandonment of normatively motivated social conflicts prevent him from thinking beyond capitalism. So that's it.
So, hello, everybody. First of all, I need to make a kind of stride from the previous concept. I think that my presentation is more in the concept or in the way of crisis, but more in the way of context of disasters. And having that in mind, I have took a kind of exploring based on national research of the Serbian population or social structural transformation in Serbia. I try to compare with classical exploration of apathy, resignation, and desperateness, which is Marienthal's study from 1930, and some new contemporary research of Gallup and Heltway's well-being research. So, one of the goals of the exploration was exploration of vulnerability and resilience, I started with the hypothesis that from a global perspective, the poor are the most vulnerable in a disaster, and one of the main goals was detection of basic human anticipation potentials in such marginal groups, which could lead to the exploration of the possible types of coping strategies toward resilience enhancement. I define resilience as a capacity for planning, but resilience is in most of the cases different among different social group, but also is a different in the same social group or is unequal. That means that in time when disaster occur or in aftermath, the vulnerability in same population is unequal. From that perspective, some of the question or issues are: how big is the group of the people without or with impaired resilience? That is, people with an endangered outlook within a marginal community. What are the dimensions and indicators of their desperateness? Are there short-term or longer aspiration jeopardized, and so on? Now, jump to the about 8 years ago. What are the main hypotheses, goals, findings, and methodology which Paul Lazarsfeld and others used in Marienthal study? That was sociographical research of unemployment community in one small place in Austria, just before Second World War, we can that say, but in the time of big recession. And one of the main hypotheses was that prolonged unemployment leads to a state of apathy. Victims do not utilize any longer even the few opportunities left to them. And one of the findings or conclusion was that it was imperative to teach them how to utilize their chances. Methodology which was, I can say, for the first time used in sociological research was a kind of synthesis between statistics and qualitative research or full description of concrete observation. Research was, I think, the field work was placed in the same in the Marienthal about 3 or 4 months in period of 2, 3 or 4 months. So researchers have time to observing population, and they use the example of the methodologies that they use a common population statistic, also voting statistic, but they also observe a situation on the terrain, like they analyze lunches of the families and kids, lunches for school, and they analyze also the expenses of family 1 day before unemployment relief and 1 day after unemployment relief money. So also they analyze, as example, the number of denunciation in case of casual working and in concurrently accepting unemployment relief. So they find that increase in personal malice, and that means that unfounded denunciation increased in number, while founded denunciation remain unchanged. Two main aspects of were explored: attitudes toward unemployment and effects of unemployment. We do not have time to go into details of the exploration. Now I jump in the present time, that is the Gallup and Healthway Global Research of Global Wellbeing Index, which is based precisely on 10 questions, very general questions, and they use a national representative samples for each state. I think 155 states was observed, and you can see that they have several categories and elements. There are 5 elements: proposed social, financial, community, and physical well-being. And the way the measurement is thriving, struggling, and suffering. As you see, the category of struggling is most prevalent, and also category of suffering is also very very dominant. There are definition of the each category, so you can see what means thriving, struggling, and suffering. It's, I think, common stem. Due to the place of the conference, I pick up percentage of Serbian population, and we can then compare with my data, which I get from the let's say similar exploration. We can see that in the element or category of thriving in three or more elements, there are only 10% of Serbian population. Also, a very important percentage for my exploration is that the 46% of Serbian population is in the state of suffering regarding purpose well-being. Also, the number of element thriving is speak that about half of Serbian population does not thrive in any of elements. Now I will mostly orient my discussion presentation in the way of my research or research of the Institute for Sociological Research, the Faculty of Philosophy. The concrete research was based on the national research, as I say, which is the challenges of new social integration concept and agents. I was very interested in one particular question for the questionnaire, and that was open question, which more or less allowed do you have any plans to enhance your life condition in next 1 or 2 years? Related to that question was one set of similar questions, and I used that set of questions for creating a specific methodology, which I present very soon. But the general idea was to use, I call that phenomenology of desperateness, which was based on sociological imagination and social action. There is some of most important findings, that is that indicators of miserable life were labeled and detected, and that such analytical dimension become marked as the indicators of vulnerabilities. Mapping these vulnerabilities, especially among the marginal communities, are the first step in preventing their victimization. Now, this is some data about social structure of the apathy or of the desperateness or no resilience in Serbia. In the national sample, total number of individuals who have plans to enhance their life condition in next 1 or 2 years is 50.3%, and they are representing the people with the resilience. In contrast, there are 49.7% individuals who are vulnerable or non-resilient. Maybe this is a good moment to explain correlation between vulnerability and resilience. As example, one person or group could be vulnerable, but in same time can be also very resilient. And in contrast to that, if you detect decrease of resilience in some group, that for sure lead in vulnerability of that group or the person. Now, this percentage of about 50% individuals without purpose is can be compared with the Gallup data, which was more or less the same. And now something about structure of the people without life perspective. There are retired people without plans about in the 50%. Unemployment, which I especially explored, without plans is about 50%. And desperate housewives or apathetic help is about 8%. So that means that from about 1,000 and 100 people without plan, at least 70% was from those three groups. And this is the main let's say methodological frame which I use for this research. And I created one new variable, which was possessing plan is one, and without plan is zero. So I just use a very simple relation between indicators, socioeconomic, demographical, regional data, which I related or just tested with the life outlook or the new variable, which is with plan or without plan. So I mark difference and similarities between two group of unemployment people. Those group are with plans and without plans. And there are several dimensions, like reduction of the possibility, catalyst of interaction, reduction of longer aspiration. And then second catalyst of interaction, which was different from this first potential of disappointment. And there are also find that preserved basic human anticipation potentials among both groups. I believe that I don't have time for the detailed explanation of such of these charts. So you can see that I put just a few examples. Maybe it's interesting as example that the devastation of everyday life lead to the decreasing of life perspective, and as a result we have a carelessness in among the family. So the people became a bit devastation of day structure, carelessness. The also very interesting is the action potential. We can see that that is the second from the left. That is in both group of the unemployment, the very small gap is between group where the money is priority. And that can be analyzed in several ways. One of the way is that way that speak that that we have also devastation of the let's say class cohesion or solidarity in such groups. Now, if we use in my research, if we use a hypothesis of Marienthal, okay, I will finish very soon. If you use a hypothesis that longer, very long unemployment lead to the desperateness or apathy or resignation, I tested also that hypothesis again, and we can see here on the chart regional distribution of resilience in Serbia, and we can see in the region of West Serbia and Shumadia that about 40 people is without life outlook. And in the table left, we see that in very same region, unemployment rate is the lowest. And employed rate is highest. Also, in the same region, long unemployment is 82% highest again, and very long unemployment is again the highest. That actually means that employment or unemployment rate is not always related to desperateness or apathy in one unemployment community. And then this is a general, conclusion that reduction of possibility lead to the reduction of a longer aspiration like re-education or establishing family and so on, but they are also catalysts of interaction, which are pull and push factors in this vicious circle. And this is something. Okay, I do not go into details. I'll try to make one model for changing disaster, which is disaster risk reduction model. And it's based on the previous big table with the difference and similarity among unemployment community. So we can combine and just use the data where you indicate some desperateness or resilience. You just put in this model and try to change something in the society or in the community. And it is a couple conclusions or implication of the research that practical implications are that responsible social agents are compatible with the creation of relevant map and profile of the most vulnerable actors with the goal of preventing a possible eugenical selection during disaster risk reduction and response. Social implications are to preventing victimization during disaster. Such study can provide preventives of the sentiment-driven action induced by paternalistically organized everyday lives within the framework of new totalitarian ideology, such as paramilitary organization of daily activities. And let's say originality or value of this approach is something between very, very broad or general research like Gallup research and very narrow research like Marienthal exploration. So I mean that some national research like research of the R Institute could be used for creating a useful model in detecting desperateness as an inner process in vulnerability and new insight into the understanding of the relation between social structure of marginal groups, their resilience, and their members' vulnerability. Okay, thank you. That's.
Okay, any questions, comments, please?
Yeah, okay, my first question is for Roscoe Muchnik, and it's about class composition and the role of unwaged informal labor in class composition, because there's a kind of ambivalence in the history of Herrerismo in terms of whether it needs to be focused on the working class at the point of production, right, and strikes and things like that, or whether it could be expanded into the unemployed, work, domestic labor, things like that. So I was wondering if you could say more about that. And then I also had a question for Mariana Tejera, I don't know if I pronounced that right, and it's just about, I wondered if you could make the idea of social pathology more concrete, because in some ways I was wondering, I'm not sure if I can follow the stakes of this analysis, because I wasn't quite sure what phenomena was being analyzed.
All right, so the unpaid work is definitely one of the most important elements of the future class composition, and it does organizationally it's present in non-formal or unorthodox types of organizations and in anarchist inspired fora in Slovenia, for instance. There is, of course, the traditional trade unions I was speaking about have great trouble at integrating precarious workers and are completely unable, of course, to deal with the unpaid work. So I would say that to answer fast, these people are organized in social centers in this kind of non-orthodox or marginal organizations, but and are politically maybe important at certain moments, like when mass protests broke up 2 years ago on the streets. These people were there, but we still have to wait for a stronger presence.
Thank you for your question. That's precisely what I couldn't read. I didn't have time to read it. So, social pathologists. Well, in Freedom's Right, in his last book, there's this distinction between social pathologies and social misdevelopments. And I think when he talks about social pathologies, he really lacks concreteness and historicity, because he talks about the unilateralization of moral and legal freedom. He gives some examples of what would that mean. In the case of legal freedom, it means that all motives to action stem from framework of framework of legal relations, so that your reason to act is not some value or some value orientation of what you think it's a good life, but instead what would you what would give you like advantage in a process of in a trial, for example, so motives that are juridically relevant. In the case of moral social pathology, you all the motives to action are also kind of internal examination of moral norms that are accepted in society. So you put them to a test, like Kant's categorical imperative, but that in both cases there's missing the connection with the context, with the social environment. But he doesn't develop much. Then he completely forgets about that in the third part of the book, which is the historical part, the historical reconstruction. And in this part, I have organized his argument in three pathologies. Pathologies, not social misdevelopments, which are economic exclusion, cultural disaggregation, and political alienation. I can talk a little bit about that more, but I think I don't want to monopolize the. I can speak about that later.
Okay.
Yes, I think I have also some comments for everyone because the three were very interesting. I begin with your one thing that triggered my attention. In your explanation of trade unions, is this staying backward in relation to the social reality and thinking with old method. I was also always very surprised of the difficulty that has the trade unions to think at least in a European level. And I remember a specific example. I was in that time working in a high school. We organized, the trade unions organized a national strike, and they even didn't know that a week before there was the same strike for the same reasons in the UK, and a week later in France. And they couldn't even, I don't know, read the newspapers and know what is going on in the neighbor countries. And this is something shocking for me, because is this a cognitive problem to think in another scale, or is it a political problem related to the bureaucratization of trade unions? That's my first question. And very rapidly, a comment about Honneth. I think that the wording in terms of pathologies, it was at the beginning of Honneth, when they were close to Habermas. Both were using the model of psychoanalysis, and Lorenzo and this director. And this was helping to understand what ideology critique was about. But the whole notion of ideology was lost in the way, and I think it's important to keep it, to understand what false consciousness is. And more than a question, it's a comment about your work that I found very interesting. I think that you would be fascinated if you read something about the movement in Spain against evictions, because it's a very good example of what happens when these people who has been victimized and is desperate because it's going to lose their house and go at the street. They understand, because of the help of other people who surround them, they understand that they are not simply losing their home because they are unable to pay the rent or they are unable to find a solution, but they are victims of a trap. And
as soon as they began to engage in this political reframing of what is going on, people who were thinking of suicide changed radically. So I think this is a factor you should add also. The rate of political consciousness. Why did I finish it like that? Thank you.
Should you answer?
Yes, well, Slovenia is a small country, so international awareness is very present because, especially towards former Yugoslavia. So the problem is more organizational, that issues are being presented and resolved either on national level or on European level. And on European level is the European Trade Union Confederation that's organizing manifestations in Brussels. So all the European trade unions come and have this kind of, let's say, spectacular show off with uneven result. While other issues, those I was showing, were national issues, and this, let's say, division of labor between European bureaucracy and national governments is a strategy that is very difficult to break. I didn't have photos to show you that in most big manifestations in Ljubljana, trade unions from Trieste, Rijeka and Zagreb took part. So there was an international, at least symbolical dimension. Now the problem is this split between awareness and organizational capacity. For instance, trade unions in Slovenia were the first to oppose Bolkestein directive, you know, the
yes.
Which failed, and then it was they had a press conference, and nobody of the you could see that the journalists couldn't understand what they are speaking about. So definitely they had this awareness, and also they were the first to open the issue of migrant workers, which is a way of super exploitation. And in Slovenia, it's linked to Bosnian workers mostly, or to workers from Macedonia, Croatia. So, so you know, it's exploiting your former co-citizens. But they haven't found organizational schemes how to integrate migrant workers or precarious workers. They have a kind of policy which is quite sympathetic, but they don't have mobilizatory potential as yet. So let me stop that, you know, speaking about Slovenian trade unions is speaking about an exception. And one of the European Trade Union Confederation guys said to me, well, we in Europe, we have radical rhetorics and mild politics, while in Slovenia they have mild rhetorics with radical politics.
Yeah, I'm really glad you asked that question, because I think I have this philosophical bad habit of dissecting every argument but not getting to the essential. And I think that's exactly what I wanted to, the idea that I want to argue. I think, as you said, Honneth and Habermas have a really close relationship to psychoanalysis in the beginning of their works. There is a difference, I think, in that Honneth makes a more consistent use of authors such as Winnicott or Jessica Benjamin in the theory of object relations. However, Habermas, who relies solely on Freud, I think he has a more interesting approach to psychoanalysis in the sense that he does not intend to appropriate the content of Freud's theory, but the methodological approach So he compares the analyst with the critical theorist and the patient with the social movements. So there's got to be a dialogue, and I think it's an interesting way of trying to escape from the dichotomy from like external observation or participation. I think this dialogue, unfortunately, Habermas abandoned that. Even in the 70s, I think he doesn't talk much about this anymore. From the 80s onwards, even less. And so I have this in mind, and I'm trying to put Honneth against himself from this point of view. So that's kind of what I was trying to do.
So I will short comment. Thank you for the comment. Now, we have seen that capitalism is very flexible or very dynamic system, and that is interesting. And it is not the question how socialism can live with the apathy, because we have seen that it became a very petrified system, and then in certain moments just broke up. But what happens with apathy and capitalism? How apathy influences our civic or political engagement in capitalism? That is a very good question. And I can speak only from historical perspective. And I also operate with apathy in that way. For me, apathy is not just a state of mind or a sentiment. It is more sentiment, but it is also a kind of action, sentiment-driven action. So, if one population, we have seen in the demonstration in Slovenia, how decreased the population which take part in demonstration, that with the flow of time, the population became not more revolutionary, but more apathetic. So apathy can be used as kind of message of the population to the government to be more charitable, if you know what I mean. And that is something that I call transformation of a state of well-being into the state of altruistic states, which that is government which provide a basic rights to the marginal group as a kind of charity. And in such constellation, apathy is just one mode of life, which is pretty dangerous if apathetic society encounter disaster situation or emergent situation like war, epidemic, earthquakes and so on.
Floods,
yeah. We can see.
Question for the first speaker. You mentioned that both working class and bourgeoisie failed in their efforts to organize themselves. And in this way, they proved the inability to integrate their class politics into contemporary processes of capitalism and probably struggle against capitalism. But maybe I'm wrong, but I have the impression that they, in their failure, they integrated themselves perfectly, because we don't have a coherent class politics in the global sphere as well. For example, the notion of multitude is so plausible because we don't have this unification and composition within the class, as you mentioned. So it seems for me that they are integrated in their failure. And I have a question for the second speaker as well. You mentioned that in recent writings, Honneth expressed his concern about capitalist transformation of subjectivity. But it seems to me, and maybe you disagree, but his account on struggle for recognition at the personal, individual level was already contaminated by this capitalist subjectivity. And I have several questions for the third speaker. Your perspective is completely new for me. As I understand, you have your own contribution as shifting the perspective of disaster. So how do you define disaster? Is something which happens or something which we have to prevent? Because from my point of view, it seems that your perspective create of disaster creates victims. And also, it seems to me that it's part of neoliberal strategy to prevent the risk and to manage everything and to take the temporality and uncertainty of the future and to neutralize it.
Okay, thank you.
Should I?
No, no,
Marianne. No. Of course, if you fail to compose yourself into a class, then you are integrated by the system on its own terms. And that's being, that's happening both with the working classes or groups in all our countries, as well as with the bourgeoisie. The result is the growing unemployment in our societies and the growing precariousness of labor relations. We are still using in specialist literature the expression non-standard labor relations, but in Slovenia 70% of the new jobs that are opened are non-standard, so it's an anachronistic terminology. So that's how you are integrated into the system with surplus exploitation, on the basis of surplus exploitation. And here, for instance, if I come back to the unpaid work, the state is organizing unpaid work, because in certain professions you have to have a kind of, you know, stage in order to be qualified to perform, like in medicine, in law, in public services, certain public services, etc. So the state is organizing those preparation stages that are unpaid. It's incredible, but that's how it is. The whole NGO scene is, regardless of the ironic remarks of Professor Merkel, is NGO scene and artistic scene are based on unpaid work. And that's also part of the system and part of the state regulations. So that's how the working people are being integrated. Now, how the bourgeoisie or whatever are the ruling classes in our countries is being integrated is an open question for me. One natural hypothesis would be comprador bourgeoisie, but I'm not sure this is the case, because comprador bourgeoisie is organizing a social field within the jurisdiction, while our elites don't really do it. They rely on European Union ideas and act on the blueprints that are presented to them. So they are not even creative, class creative in the sense of comprador bourgeoisie. And that's an open field, which is both the class composition of the working people and of the bourgeoisie. It's an open field for research, but the problem is nobody wants to pay for this kind of research. I had three very good projects that were proposed and they were always refused, and sometimes with very sophisticated bureaucratic maneuvers, because we got good evaluations. So, it's an open question. It's an open question. It's very dramatic for people who work, and I think it's surrealistic or grotesque for the elites.
Thank you for your question. Well, I do not define disaster now, what is actually disaster, because it's a very long definition, but can also the fall in the main telecommunication system can be also disaster. So that is open question, relatively open question. But how I see disaster? I see disaster always related to the social structure or transformation in social structure. You have right when you say that it could be disaster risk reduction could be used in a neoliberal way. But actually, the measure which I propose, I think that the neoliberal government will be not happy with such measure because they understand the structural transformation instead of change in technical structure or resources, medical resources, and so on. So that is big difference in comprehending of disaster. And if you just look at, or compare the same disaster like flood or a tsunami or I don't know earthquake in the different countries, you will see what are the effects of disaster. As example, Chile and Haiti or New Orleans, and what's happened after the disaster. That is also depend of the structure of society. There is in fact in New Orleans the floods is used for replace the very poor black population to another area, and it's a kind of gentrification, you know. The territory is used for the building of new modern capacities. So that's the more question of the structure.
Okay.
Yeah.
The last question.
Well, just two short comments because everybody's tired. I think one is to ask and the other is to listen. I will begin with to listen. I think interesting thing would be to show how does everybody understand where does the misery come from?
Mm-hmm.
So, is it related to the position of Serbia in the global capital system, or is it related to other things? And the second thing would be interesting to see, because you said, or the one point was that there's not a big difference between people who are employed and unemployed. I think the interesting thing would be to see how much of their income is left to these employed people, so they can just plan something. They are simply paying their bills and that's it. The question or suggestion to Rodasco, if I understood you well, I completely agree with you. I'm from Slovenia myself too. I completely agree with you, and you used the case of Nura, our textile factory. I think the important thing to say, which you know of course, would be that unofficially or officially European community itself led this strategy to just outsource textile industry and other industries into, I don't know, India or whatever. And if I understood you well, your point at the end was that neoliberal ideology at the center goes hand in hand with neoconservatism at the periphery. So they are somehow interlaced. And maybe that would be the answer to this question whether there is a national bourgeoisie or comprador bourgeoisie, and why comprador bourgeoisie in our country doesn't need any jurisprudence or any official program, etc. Because it is already somehow there out.
Should I answer? Okay, I do not write the question, so I try. So the first, I presented wrong, but there is a difference between apathy, between unemployment and employment people, of course, because you know your money give you a chance to the various way of life. So I don't know, but there are some differences and similarities in the very same groups like unemployment, which are more vulnerable than employment people or other class, let's say. Similarity and differences, I try to find what are specific indicators for the differences or similarities. And I don't have time to present all, but there are demographical indicators in education. You can suppose that people with higher education is less apathetic in case of unemployment. Also, young population have the less chance to find the job, but they are still the most agile or most most flexible population among unemployment. And there are also socioeconomic or regional indicators who make difference or make difference in the very same group. And similarity is in the action potential, and that is the money as priority when you look to the job. And also what is preserved a basic human anticipation potential, that is potential to survive. And I measure that through the using our own fields to produce food and drinks and etc. By that indicators I measure. And second question, I don't remember what was.
Okay. Yeah, I think, thank you. I mean, you actually structured my presentation in a more firm way, and that's a nice idea. I think it's a good hypothesis. Neoliberalism in center, neoconservatism in the periphery. But I will end with the ambiguity of the situation, complexities. On my particular field, the university work. In Ljubljana University was completely wiped out by Bologna reform, and it was practically destroyed with internal forces, not with outside pressure. While if I look at the Zagreb University or Beograd University, as conservative institutions, they resisted better this destruction. And well, I was told I should not believe everything I read. So I was looking at the study programs and composition of curriculum, etc. But still, they, as conservative, very old institutions that don't move, they have conserved a structure which can be used for future development. While in Ljubljana, it's very, very questionable. Okay, so. Okay.